Hello and welcome, everyone. I'm very excited to be here today with X and Marianne to talk to you. As Chris has said, I'm Curator of Australian Art here at the Gallery. I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we gather, recognise that it was never ceded, and pay my respects to Elders past, present and emerging. So thanks so much for joining us for the opening day of exDeMedici Beautiful Wickedness. I just wanted to make a note that this is being filmed, so we won't be able to go to questions at the end. However, there'll be opportunities after the conclusion of the talk for us to all speak to X and Marianne. So, delighted to have you here to kick off the public programs for the exhibition. We're here to discuss one of the most significant themes underpinning the exhibition, which is the relationship between art and science, and specifically X's 20-year-plus engagement with Dr. Marianne Horak, AO for many years an entomologist at the CSIRO's Australian National Insect Collection. So welcome, Marianne and X. There's been a lot of talk in recent years about the relationship between art and science, and I think the relationship that you two have developed in your work really embodies one of the principles underlying that concept, which is that there's lots of similarities between the vocations. So to provide some context, would each of you share a little bit about your background prior to the collaboration? For example, Marianne, I was interested to hear you talk about your student days and about how you were the only female student in your University of Science lectures, and also to hear about your early field work collecting moths in Papua New Guinea.
Yes, I started quite a long time ago, and I was interested in geology, and in Zurich then, I was the only female in the geology lectures, which was challenging, but yeah. Then.
And how did you used I to had, be, sorry? I was going to say, how did you used to be introduced? How did the professor introduce? He used to say.
Yeah, when the professor came in the 60s, you used to tap with your pencil. And once when I came late, and it was a raked auditorium like here, the students tapped until I sat. So I knew either I was early or I did not go to the lectures. It was quite clear. But what Samantha alluded to, I mean, my good fortune was that early in life, I come from Europe, as you can hear, the European fauna is impoverished through the ice ages and has been studied 100 years ago. There's very little new to be found. And I was lucky enough to first live for 2 years in New Zealand, and then, even more exciting, 2 years in New Guinea, where I started collecting my little moths. And then went back to Switzerland and did first a master's and then a PhD. And there I realized that the Southern Hemisphere fauna is so much more exciting and that these things are old. They have preserved some of the early characteristics, and that we can understand evolution much better if we actually look at the southern fauna. And that was what eventually brought me back to Australia.
Yeah, great. Okay, thanks. And X, I mean, you've worked across a range of mediums and subjects, but would it be fair to say that the environment has always been one of your key concerns?
Absolutely, for a very, very long time. And I think possibly not just the environment, but those who choose to destroy it has actually been much more centralised. But I think working with Marianne made me much more interested in those that live in that environment as well. And I guess you've got to remember too that everything is utterly interdependent. So working with her, we understand that the botany is imperative as well. Nothing can be separated. And I think we live in a Newtonian construct that everything can be separated and still exist. Well, it can't. Yeah. And so, look, you know, I have no science training at all. Yeah. And I think after 20 years, I'm still a bit, you know.
And I mean,
but I've learned enormous amounts since I've worked with Marianne.
But of course, you know, for 20 years prior to that, you weren't engaging with science in quite the same way. You were interested in it, but you know, you were working on other things.
Oh, yes. look, again, you know, this has been an interesting process because I'm not a person to look backwards, and we've just looked backwards for the last 3 years. So I've tended to just race forward, and it's been a very interesting process of, I guess, assessing what I never assessed before. And so I think my engagement as a political beast has always been there from art school days.
Yes.
So I think over a long time you learn to refine your ideas and refine how you deliver them. Yep. I think when I was younger I was a bit more curmudgeonly. But, you know, you do learn, and you, through feedback or through offending somebody or getting slapped over the wrist by an unbelievably bad critique in a newspaper, which I have had numerous, that you, you know, if you want to stay in, you have to find the way that to deliver what you want to say in a more efficient way.
Yeah, a more strategic way.
Yeah.
Okay, so thanks. And let's now move on to the story that started it all, which goes back to the year 2000. X, can you tell us how the collaboration first came about?
Okay, I was, I'd been, so previous to that, I'd been working in tattooing. Tattooing paid all the bills. We couldn't sell work. I worked within a collective gallery, and that lasted 15 years. Nobody made money. Nobody could sell anything. Nobody was interested in buying anything except the dead. And so, you know, eventually you just have to find a way to live because we live in a Western society. It's not free. So I was working on a film with Tony Ayres in Melbourne, his first film. He was a colleague at art school. And there's one colleague from art school here today, Rox De Luca, which is really wonderful. So Rox knows these sorts of things. So Tony had decided he was involved in printmaking and photography, and he had always been interested in the narrative and decided to become a filmmaker. So he'd gone down to Swinburne in Melbourne to do a year postgraduate in filmmaking and basically pulled a bunch of his friends in to work on his first film. None of us really knew anything other than the tech guy, the sound guys were very experienced and the DOP was experienced, but we were just sort of, you know, rat bags. And so I got my first tattoo on that shoot. It was I was down there for 3 months, and it was terribly executed by a drunk, and at 11 o'clock at night. And,
good idea. That was
big lessons we learned. So I decided, you know, one of my primary skills is drawing, and it's primarily drawing, but there's a lot more. It's a very different medium, a different thing. So I thought, oh, I can do better than that. And so that was a process. Another year went by, and I wrote funding to Osco to go to the US to do an apprenticeship. And I got it, which was, you know, surprising for others at the time.
And Bronwyn Bishop wasn't successful in getting you to pay the money back. She wasn't impressed by the idea that it was some kind of artistic practice.
No, it was vile and disgusting. So I'd spent many years in tattooing because, you know, any skill takes a long time to learn. Any skill, even like martial arts, do it 10,000 times and you might start to begin to understand what you're doing. So I'd sort of walked away. I saw a giant boom in 1999 that tattooing was just going to go ballistic in the West, and I just thought that was a good time to leave. And so I sort of...
She's contrary. Contrary. Very contrary.
So I built a studio at my house and started working on Big Blue and Big Red. That took me quite a long time because I'd never worked in that medium before. And I I was talking to an old teacher of mine, Leanne Crisp, from the art school, had come over to have a look at what I was doing. And I said I wanted, you know, it's a big mess of stuff, and I said I wanted to get some insect specimens in there from Norfolk Island. Mm-hmm. And she said, oh, I know someone. And it was one very, you know, innocuous introduction that, you know, you're on a track. It's, I guess, this thing you think you know where you're going. You're on a track and one thing happens and it's a sharp right turn.
Yeah.
And that was meeting Marianne, produced a sharp right turn in everything I did.
Yep, amazing.
Yep.
And Marianne, from your point of view, what was your experience of meeting X for the first time and finding out about her work?
Well, I was at the time in charge of the moss and the Lepidoptera moss and butterflies at the Australian National Insect Collection, and I had artists come before who would like to borrow mostly butterflies. I always would try to steer them to the moss. We have 400 butterflies. We have thousands, tens of thousands of moss in the country. And anyway, usually they would say, yes, they are pretty, and go. So when X came, X brought a little sketch of a dead butterfly she had picked from the fender of her car. And it was an incredible picture. This beautiful thing that was so dead. So, and I mean, I looked at that and thought, whoa, who is she? But it was amazing. But, I mean, I'm not there to judge. Anybody can paint what they find in the National Insect Collection. But what I said to her, I said, yes, of course you can have your butterfly, but I would like you to look up.
Just one sec. I think, is it in this picture? No, I think this is just a detail that we can't see. But anyway, carry on, sorry.
Ah, the butterflies.
Oh, yeah, I thought it's on the screen behind us. Can you
see? On the right-hand side.
Yep.
Is a red dome, and under that red dome is a yellow-red butterfly.
Oh, yeah.
Can you see?
Mm, yep, we can.
So that's off the grill.
Yep. No, 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 that was not off the grill. From the collection.
Oh, was that one from the collection? Oh, okay, right, not a busted one.
And I gave X a little box of my moss. And I'd done that several times before, and people said, yeah. And X said, I'll come back tomorrow. And that was
the beginning of it all.
And I mean, for me, that, I mean, apart from a sustaining friendship for now 20 years, it's also, I came here as a foreigner in this country and often felt, why do you destroy this wonderful country with this incredible fauna and flora? And as a scientist, you only have so much reach. But artists reach much, much further. And I saw a kindred spirit in X immediately, that together we could spread the message much, much further. And that has been an incredible pleasure.
Yeah. And
X came back the next day and started. These were some of the first ones, these small ones she painted. And then the next one, she came with a gun. And a colleague of mine, a very, very good lepidopterist, the best lepidopterist in the country, he nearly had a heart attack when he first saw it.
But you won him over in the end.
Totally.
Yes,
right. Yes. Ted
is a convert.
Fire for X now.
Yeah, and so X too. Just that experience of walking into the collection and the smells and the sights and the sounds. What was that like for you?
Naphthalene is firmly drilled into my brain. You have to go through it. Well, they're making new buildings for the collection at the moment, and so the old building is where I have done most of the work. But you go through an airlock, or you sort of come up the stairs and you go, there's a copy of Joseph Banks's collection when he was on the Endeavour. They're not the actual specimens, but they're the same animals that he had collected on that first trip. And So you go through an airlock and then you open the door into the collection room and it's a wall of naphthalene. Mm. And I did feel like after I'd spend a day in there, I get home and my hair, my clothing, everything was naphthalene, you know. It's a very, but it's the only really effective method of controlling invading insects, yeah. isn't it? So, you know, I've seen what can happen where, because we have, we are in the Bogong path in Canberra, and they get in through the air conditioning vents and everywhere, even if it, even though it's airlocked. But it can do enormous damage and destroy very serious research materials.
Mm. Yep. And so anyway, you were inspired, you both inspired, and then you applied to the Australia Council for another grant. I think it was the last grant.
My last grant ever.
Last grant that you yeah. applied for, yeah, because after that you sort of thought, leave it to other people.
I was earning money and I didn't, yeah. I think that AusCo is, or what is going to be something different soon.
Creative Australia.
We'll always know it as the Australia Council.
But I think it's a place for emerging artists and artists who want to do more difficult work when you're starting out. It's very important. They were really, really helpful to me when I was a young artist. And so I had started to earn money. Tattooing was paid for, you know, 15 years of my life, every bill. I was still working, making exhibition work at night, but that was mostly for museum work, so still no earnings off the work that you're doing. So I felt that I made that my swan song for funding, that I could afford to fund my own projects, and so that's the way it went. So that last... The last time I applied for funding was to do the research group for in that year.
Yep, in 2001 you went for the formal residency at the very beginning of that year.
I exhibited in 2001, so...
Yes, in November.
Yeah. Yep. So after that, you know, and again, there are always issues with funding. You are definitely tied to protocols. And I do love the idea that, you know, with my own money I can just
do whatever I want without
providing a rationale or a forward projection or, you know, all of the things that are virtually impossible to forward project anyway. But, of course, like, you know, there have to be safeguards for funding. But I do believe that if you can afford to make work, then you don't take funding and you leave that for younger artists who are coming in who do need it.
Yes.
I'm quite... Adamant about this.
And so you had the residency and then you had an exhibition at Helen Maxwell Gallery in Canberra, SP, which is the abbreviation for species, and there was 27 pairs of moths and arrowheads that you made for that show. We have 12 pairs in the exhibition and they sold out and you were shocked and Marianne wasn't. Is that right?
No, I was super shocked. And unfortunately we couldn't track down the rest of them because the gallery, Helen Maxwell's gallery, closed and she'd moved and all those records were gone.
But we have a really strong group and in a way, you know, the way that the display, the vitrines that Melissa has designed, they're a really lovely example of that very first practice. And, of course, the significance of the moths and the arrowheads, the moths symbolise nature and the fragility of life. And then the arrowheads, which are formed from the four wings of the insect.
Are the first base weapons.
The first weapon that we created, and that's an ongoing discourse in your practice.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think just one point here. Mostly over the whole period, I've worked with Marianne's group, and given that I don't know anything about what Marianne does, you know, really, it's utterly superficial, I think. But I welcomed her mentorship and was prepared to be guided by her too. I think it's quite an important aspect of how we've worked.
Well, here I also have to say that, I mean, we taxonomists, we actually recognise our animals, but that's not how you identify them. You do that with microscopes and dissections and whatever. But it was very interesting for me to watch X, who developed exactly the same skills very quickly. She knew exactly what was related with which, just looking at the what we in German call Gestalt. And nobody really can explain that, but it's clearly something that exists.
Pattern recognition.
Pattern, well, yeah.
Ish. Yeah. But I have to add here that I used to really desperately try to get onto their field trips, and I'm not a scientist, that's a big no. I can't cook, and that's a big no. So it didn't really leave me anywhere that I could jump into those trucks and go off with them.
Well, the problem really, as we all would have loved to have you there, but CSIRO bureaucracy would never allow an outside.
I tried.
I'm sure you did.
The legal, I mean, that would be the end of any collective trip.
Yeah, but they would be getting all the food ready. We'd all be stacked up to the roof, and all the trucks were being prepared, and I'd be like, you know, Cinderella, back sweeping the chimney sweep.
Actually making the work, to be honest. But you write beautifully, Marianne. You both write beautifully in the catalogue, and you talk about that pattern recognition and how really there's sort of no words to describe it, but that the artworks capture that, which is amazing. And next, so just thinking a little bit about the way you do reproduce the sort of patterning and the beauty of the moths, you're obviously not working with the naked eye. There's a kind of a scientific approach to the way you create the artworks.
Well, they're too small to see, so you've got to you must look through a microscope for them. So I just work directly microscope to page. I don't use any form of technology other than really, really old technology, and they're not truly scientific.
No, they're not
a truly scientific approach. Would be every scale would be counted, every single, you know, joint in an antennae would be counted. So they're not really valuable as scientific work, but it's enough to give an impression of what they are in a fairly
detailed way. Oh, yes, you do give a slight impression of what they are. No, I mean, yeah. I think when you have the chance to have a look at the exhibition, and particularly with that last room, just the level of detail that you do bring to the artworks is quite amazing and quite captivating.
It's kind of fun working from 2 millimetres to 120 centimetres. You know, that they are so tiny, but as soon as you see them under a microscope, again, it's this thing where if we can't, you know, we see something and we just swat it and kill it. And I know that the insects are dead, but there's a reason why they exist within the collection. But in our general life, we just see a little thing there and just kill it. It's like, whatever. And then you look at it and you go, oh, I'm not going to kill that. I am a lifetime vegetarian as well, so I don't like killing animals. But I have to say I've had some great nights where I'd be working in summer and I'd have my doors open and all these other animals would be coming in because of the light.
Yes.
And I had a great moment with a praying mantis who came in and literally just went under my microscope.
Oh, wow.
And looked straight at me.
I know what you're doing.
And I discovered that praying mantises have perfectly circular mouths that are deep crimson on the inside with teeth all around. Like, it was very weird and it sort of... So looking at them alive is a very different thing to looking at them dead.
And you do see, perhaps you can both add to this conversation, because there's a huge amount of detail. They have these pelts, that's what you often talk about them as, but the fine detail of the sort of makeup of the wings is quite amazing. Like you talked about the fragility of that sort of surface, and it's almost like dust.
Marianne?
The scales. I mean, that is what makes Lepidoptera moths and butterflies, that the hair most other insects have developed into scales, which is basically a fur, keeps them warm so they can fly at night. Just keeping the warmth of their flight muscle movements, they can fly at night and thus escaped their main predator, the birds. And that is really one of the successes of the butterflies and moths. And to paint, of course, these is very difficult. And eggs nearly always, basically always said, you choose the moths. And I remember often thinking, my God, this will be so difficult to paint. She will hate me, you know, phantom.
And I think yet you did say you don't want to paint any more brown moths.
I did a lot of brown ones last year.
Yeah. So actually this is...
And you never saw a brown moth. You never see the brown moths.
but I did use a lot of various brown pigment. Yeah. It's a strong group.
So actually that jump, that brings us forward in the conversation to what you're sort of starting to talk about now, to the outbreak of COVID and what happened then, because COVID, in fact, for you was an opportunity, and Marianne was a partner in crime in this respect. you delivered a small box of...
I hadn't... X had been painting other things and I hadn't really... she hadn't been painting most for some time and I fully understood that. I mean, there is an end to how long one can be fascinated by one thing. As a scientist, I also go on and on. But then X was painting a very, very difficult painting. What is the exact title of it?
The wreckers.
And it's a beautiful, terrible thing. And you called the last day before COVID where we could go into the collection and said, I have finished that. I need to do something.
I need some relief.
Yeah. I need moths. And I thought, okay, there is no time to make a loan. There is no time to do this the right way. So I still had a little box of beautiful moths, which I had collected 50 years ago in New Guinea, that had lost the abdomen, which is basically the scientific, the genitalia is what we use scientifically to classify them. So they were scientifically valueless. But they were beautiful, and that's why I kept them. I didn't have the heart to throw them up. So I just got this box and said, well, that's it.
I think I turned up to do some work. I'd working on the crystal, the verdigris, which is another story, but Marianne was waiting for me out the back of the CSIRO and said, it's gone, we're locked, everyone's gone.
Yep.
Here. It's that's what you do. This will keep you gainfully occupied for a year.
And then, of course, they were just two pairs of wings, a head and no abdomen, because that was why they were scientifically valueless. So, of course, trust eggs. When I next saw them, the abdomen was replaced with a bomb or a poisonous chemical. And, I mean, it is what I I'm so fascinated, and I also laugh that you told me very early on my intention is seduce and destroy. Painting something really beautiful and you look at it and you rejoice and then all of a sudden you realise, my God, what I'm admiring, you know, has a sting in the tail. And
I think to the site of reproduction on those animals, I made the site of destruction.
That's right. Ah, yeah, I never thought of that. Yes. Of course. Yeah.
And you did that because, you know, in a sense, what you're sort of placing humans against nature in that way, and you're sort of revealing to us the kinds of things that we've devised that are sowing the seeds of our destruction and the destruction of everything around us.
I think corporations are sowing the seeds of our destruction.
Corporations.
I think so. Yes. It seems the populations don't like it very much, but it doesn't matter.
Mm.
They just keep rolling over everything.
Yeah, there is an ongoing conversation all the way through, right from if you go back to red, for example, and then one of the last moths that you've made is the Dutch East India Company, and the ensign replaces the abdomen in that moth.
Yes.
So that's about, you know, that very early idea of conquest and
exploitation, pretty much.
They were slave traders. They were known to be slave traders.
Yes, but also goods traders and opium carriers to China and, you know, the list is a long, long, a list as long as your arm that the East India Company caused. Mm. But again, look, you know, I think that primarily, I started those moths as weapons in the very get-go. It was just about how those moths became more developed and I guess it's sort of like a taxonomy of human destructiveness.
And there's also an interesting aspect to the work in the sense that the second series, double-crossed, you've not just crossed the moth with a weapon or what have you, but you've got two different, it's the same species, but it's a different, appear differently because of the fact that they're collected from New Guinea or Australia. Am I correct in thinking?
That there were two sets, one, the male and female, on half male, half female, and the other one, the same related species, one New Guinea and one
Australia.
And when X first suggested that as a scientist, I thought, will that work? And then when she brought the first one, I realised how brilliant it was because our eye tries to... correct it. And I looked at this picture and briefly I corrected it and then it fell into two different pictures again. And, I mean, they are mesmerising.
Well, it's also, too, how the brain is doing something that you don't know it's doing, where you're attempting to make one side the same as the other.
Yep.
And they are definitely not the same. You know, there's the double-double, they are all two different, an Australian and a New Guinea species, but they look similar, but you know they're wrong, but the brain is constantly making them the same.
Actually, did you see the one just now? That's actually the same genus. One, the black and white. Sorry, accident.
That's all right.
The black and white.
Okay, can we go back to that
imitates
image? Oh, great, fantastic.
A bird dropping when the wings are closed. It looks like a bird dropping, white and black. And the inedible. And the other one, these are animals in the moss forest, the mountain moss forest around Pulola. And it's all green and mossy and furry and lichen. So they are closely related, but two totally different
totally
strategies.
Different. That one is quite, was the one, I think I'd run out of moths and we'd gone into another lockdown. And so I had to work on previous drawings I'd done in the collection years before. Mm. And I just sort of put them together. But they were also related to two guns. And one side had to be black and one side had to be green. Very unscientific.
but beautiful. So just to finish then, would you share with us what your next projects are going to be? Like what's coming up for you in terms of...
X is not going to work so much anymore.
I've worked constantly for... I can't even remember. So I'm feeling like I might need to have a little fill up and I haven't left Australia for 4 years. I really, really loved COVID, I have to say. It was great. But I'm feeling the call to just go out and, you know, have a look again. Yeah, so that's probably my next thing.
You did talk to me briefly about some... thoughts you've been having about copper, I think, working on copper.
Oh, yes, I've been collecting copper. And again, I kind of think I'm just winding it back further and further as technology becomes, and AI is actually going to destroy all our jobs as artists. I'm talking to all the artists in the audience. I think it's a matter of time. So I feel like, in a way, I'm going to wind it back even further. And paint on copper.
Just another challenge to set yourself. And Marianne, I mean, you've got lots of projects that you're still working on in terms of the lepidoptery and...
Well, like every older scientist, I have lots of things that need to be finished. But I also allow myself to enjoy life, to listen to music and to travel. So
yeah.
But there are still things in Australia places in Australia I want to see, even though I have been very lucky through my fieldwork to have seen so much. But it is just a wonderful, wonderful place.
Treasure house.
Absolutely.
Well, that seems like quite a good place to end. So I'd just like to thank our speakers today, exDeMedici and Marianne Horak, for the insights they've shared with us. I'll be taking a tour of beautiful Wickedness today at 2:30. So we'll start at the entrance to the exhibition, which is closest to the foyer, and you will need a ticket to join the tour. And you can also drop in and grab yourself a temporary tattoo designed by X, a stick-on one, at the temporary tattoo booths in Gallery 1.2, 2:30 today. I'd like to encourage you to join us again tomorrow for a free artist talk with Michael Zavros and Peter McKay, who's the Curatorial Manager of Australian Art at QAGOMA, and that's at 10:30. So, yeah, I'll just ask you to join me in thanking our speakers.